Well, folks, good morning. Good morning. A really warm welcome here to Birkhead Free Church. Welcome, especially if you're new here today. Some folks are on holiday or just visiting or maybe just moved to the area. We're really pleased to have you with us. My name's Peter. I'm the minister here. And you'll meet various other members of our church family through the service, including Davi, our minister in training. He'll be preaching for us later. If you are new, there's three things we'd love you to do to get to know us and for us to get to know you a little bit better. The first is to stay for coffee at the end. We'll be serving refreshments at the back there. You can also connect with us online. There's various QR codes you can scan on your service sheet. And you can also pick up a welcome pack. I would usually say they're at the end of the rows, but we're completely rearranged for a wedding yesterday, so I've got no idea where in the rows they are. But even if you're here just for the first time as a one-off, thank you, Francis, that's what they look like. Grab one of those, take them away. That'll tell you a little bit more about our church. If you have a sheet, that will guide you through our service today. As we come to God in worship, let me pray for us. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, thank you that as we meet together in the name of Jesus, you are present with us by your Spirit. Thank you that as we open your word, the Bible, you speak in power. Thank you that as we share fellowship, we are one in Christ. Father, as we meet today, help us to sing your praise as you deserve. Hear your word. Bring our prayers to you. And share love and fellowship as a church family together. And Father, may it all be for our good, for your glory, and for the spread of your kingdom in this place. Amen. In a moment, we're going to sing together some words based on Psalm 103. But first of all, listen to these words to call us to worship. Words from the book of Romans, where the Apostle Paul says, "Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable his judgments. His paths are beyond tracing out. Who has known the mind of God? Who has been his counselor? Who has ever given to God that he should repay them? For from him and through him and to him are all things, and to him be glory forever." Bless the Lord, O my soul, worship his holy name. If you're able, let's stand as we sing.
Oh,
Lord. Please do sit. And it's great to have the boys and girls here. And as usual, in just a minute, you're going to head off to your Sunday school group. We've got provision for preschool through to primary seven. But before you go, we always have a little thought for the boys and girls. And if you were here next week, you'll remember we were thinking about an unexpected journey in the Bible. And we were doing that partly because one of our mission partners, the Balbergen family, were heading off on a slightly unexpected journey to Australia to serve God in a new place. And then Paul said to me, are you going to make it a series? So ever hungry for ideas for children's talks, I said, yes. So last week, boys and girls, we heard about Joseph, didn't we? He went on some very unexpected journeys and ended up in... Well, he did end up in jail at one point. Egypt. Ended up in Egypt. But today we're fast-forwarding a little bit in time. And here's a picture. Who do you think we might be thinking about today? Which Bible character had another, in fact, several unexpected journeys? Who is it, Jamie? It is Moses. Now, there's so many unexpected journeys we could talk about in his life. When he was born, the Pharaoh was not too keen on the people of God having children, especially sons. So can you remember what did his family do to him? They put him in a... Well, in a basket first. That was an important point. And then into... He was floated off down a river. That was a very unexpected journey. And then he was found by the Pharaoh's daughter, do you remember? And taken to live in the palace. That was another unexpected journey. And then when he grew up, he began to see that the Pharaoh was treating his people very badly, and he got very angry, and he did something very wrong. Do you know what he did? You know what he did. He actually killed an Egyptian. And then he ran away to a land far away, a place called Midian, and he thought he'd escaped God and his people and the Egyptians. But what happened? One day, a very unexpected thing happened. He came across a bush that was burning, except it never burned up. And the voice of God came to him and gave him a special task to go back to Egypt. Lots of unexpected journeys. Anyway, it's a long story. And in the end, of course, he led God's people out of Egypt after God had rescued them from the Pharaoh. So I reckon there are 5, 6, 7, 8 very unexpected journeys in Moses' life. And you know, at every stage, I reckon he could have thought, who's in charge here? This all seems quite strange, quite random. Where am I going next? And I reckon there were some times when he felt he'd done the wrong thing and he'd abandoned God and his people. But all the time, God was working out his plan, even though the journeys were unexpected. And the same's true for you, boys and girls. And just in case you think you're getting off the hook and I'm doing all the talking, do you remember the Bible verse we learned last week? Yeah, thank you. Somebody does. Well, here's a little reminder. Can you see it on the screen? Should we say it together? We know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Make it harder for me, Ruth. And for them, oh, here we go. We know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. That was true for Moses. It's true for you. Make it harder, Ruth. Here we go. We know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Last one, I think, Ruth. Here we go. We know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Now, I don't know if over coffee any of the grown-ups tested you children, or indeed if you tested the grown-ups last week over coffee. But if you didn't, today's your day. So you've all been warned. Fantastic. Well, the kids are going to go out. Let me just pray for the children before they head off to their Sunday school group. Heavenly Father, thank you that those words are true, that you are a God who reigns and rules and controls all things and works in all things for the good of your people. Lord, please help us to know that, to believe it. And we pray for each one now, each child who goes through, help them to learn of Jesus, to learn of your goodness. And we pray that each one would never know a day when they don't know Jesus as Savior and Lord. Please help them and their Sunday school teachers now, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Fantastic. Well, the kids are going to head on out. And if you don't know where to go, you can follow the crowd, such as it is. Fantastic. Well, let me just give a few announcements. There's lots of things happening in the life of our church. And if you've got the other white sheet, which is tucked inside your white sheet, you'll see all kinds of things on there. Things to pray for through the week, a diary of events. Let me just highlight one or two things for your attention. The first is just to say that we were going to restart our small groups this Wednesday. We've pushed that back a couple of weeks because we're going to do some small group leader training this week. So small groups from the 24th of August. And by the way, let me say, if you're regularly coming along here, but you're not yet part of a small group, we'd love to encourage you to be. We think that's one of the best ways to get to know people, to share fellowship, to study the Bible together. So if you'd like to be involved in one, let me know and we'll fit you in. Come back tonight. We'll be continuing our journey through the book of 1 John, as we're also doing this morning. Davy's preaching this morning and me tonight. Various other things this week, but just remember we've got a coffee morning this coming Saturday. And if you would be able to sign up on the sheet at the back for things that you can bring, baking and stuff like that, that would be a great help to Alison and the team. So please do that today if you can. Of course, come along next Saturday, bring a friend, invite the community. We'll be here in the church building for that as well. You'll see our annual congregational meeting on the 17th of August as well. And then let me also say, if you turn over your sheet to the back, you'll see that from next week, we're starting a really important new series. We'll have finished 1 John by the end of today. And then for the next 5 or 6 Sundays, we're going to be journeying together on Sunday mornings through the book of Nehemiah. And alongside that, we'll be thinking about our vision as a church for the rest of the decade. Vision 2030 is not a typo. We're thinking about the next 8 years, particularly with our linkage with Elgin Free Church in mind. What will that mean? How will it work? What is our vision? And we're going to let the Lord God speak to us through this wonderful book of Nehemiah. You see, as well as part of that, we're going to share with you all our plans for the refurbishment of the church halls as well. That'll happen as part of that series. So please be here. It's a really important time for us. And pray that the Lord will speak to us and lead us as we think about the rest of the decade together. Finally, for those who get it, the Free Church magazine, the monthly record, is available at the back of the church. So if that's you, please pick that up today as well. Lots more on there you can read, but enough from me. More importantly, we're going to pray. And here comes Chris, one of our elders, to lead us in prayer. Thank you, Chris.
Let us unite our hearts in prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we join together in worship this morning, we acknowledge that you are an almighty and powerful God with abilities beyond compare, the master craftsman, creator of heaven and earth and every living thing. Lord, we give thanks and acknowledge the privilege and blessing that is ours, that we can meet publicly for worship. Lord, you know us intimately and provide for our every need, both physically and spiritually, showering us with your love. We give thanks too for the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ, your only begotten Son, who came to be Savior of mankind, the great Shepherd, who came to serve and not be served, who is a gateway to an eternity in paradise for all who accept him into their hearts and lives. Lord, we acknowledge our weaknesses and sin in our lives when we say, do and think things that are wrong and unpleasing to you, or when we turn our backs on those less fortunate than ourselves. Lord, we pray for forgiveness of our many sins and shortcomings. And we give thanks, Lord, that Jesus Christ, our Savior, is at your right hand interceding and praying for all those who love you. Lord, we pray for everyone here this morning, whether that be in person or online. We thank you for them, for the desire that you have placed in their hearts to enable us to worship you, the living and true God, for the encouragement and brotherly love that we have for each other, which you first showed to us through the ultimate sacrifice of our Savior, Jesus Christ. As we think of mission, Lord, we pray for the unreached here in Burghead and the surrounding area, those who are heading for a lost eternity, oblivious or unconcerned by your word. Lord, create in us a spirit that would want to see others coming to a saving grace, to know you personally. Grant us opportunity, courage, and wisdom. Give us the words, Lord, that we could tell others of our love for Jesus in line with our mission statement of knowing Jesus and making Jesus known. Lord, we bring before you the situation facing our brothers and sisters in the Church of Scotland here in Burghead amid rumour of closure. O Lord, we recognise the need of salvation in this village and pray for the presbytery's elders and those trusted to make important and life-changing decisions, that they might be granted wisdom and wise counsel whilst making informed decisions on the future of that congregation in this place. We think too of the Balbergen family at this time as they travel back to France before heading back to Australia. Lord, we thank you for them and thank you for the doors that you've opened up for them, blessing them in what has proved difficult times in France as they seek your direction and will in their lives. Bless them in their travels and grant them a safe journey, we pray. Lord, we pray too for our prayer partner with OMF, known personally to many of us here. We thank you for her. And as she comes to a juncture in her life, again, we pray that you would give her wisdom and direction as she looks to serve you in the advancement of your word, whatever that may be. Lord, we remember those who are struggling in the daily fight with all the pressures that a busy life can have on people. Lord, comfort them, we pray, that they would know your love and presence in their lives. For those of our number no longer able to be with us on a weekly basis, for those suffering illness at this time, those in hospital, and those awaiting medical procedures, comfort them at this time, we pray. We remember our Queen and thank you for her many years of faithful service and Christian witness to this nation. Lord, as many enjoyed celebrating the marriage of Gavin and Mandy here yesterday, we thank you for them both, for their faithful service in this place, and ask that you'd bless them abundantly in their marriage, that you would be their focus in their daily lives as they grow together in love and faith. We also give thanks for the witness and outreach that took place yesterday here through Peter's message and professing the love and faith which Gavin and Mandy have for you, Lord, acknowledging that you are the cornerstone and foundation of their relationship. Lord, we give thanks. Now, as we come under the teaching of your word, give us ears to listen, Lord, granting Davi wisdom and words to teach your ways. For we ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Chris, for leading us so well. We're going to sing again. Here are some words from Psalm 16. And they speak about the provision and the protection that we know in the Lord and the fellowship of being among his people. If you're new to us, you might not know, but we love to sing from the Psalms, the songbook of the Bible, and sometimes we sing them unaccompanied because although we love the music, it is our voices that really count. So as Emma leads us, let's stand as we sing.
Protect me, oh my God, you
Please do sit. And you'll see from your service sheet, we're going to declare together those things which are at the heart of our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. These words are a summary of the teaching of the apostles, as the name suggests, and not only do they help us to declare those things which we believe, they also unite us with Christians down through the ages and all around the world who have used these words to summarize the essential things of our faith. Maybe you're just visiting us, you're just looking into Christian things, you don't feel you can say this or yet, that's okay. But for those who can, let's declare, let's say aloud together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We're going to hear from God's word now as we continue our series in the book of 1 John. And here's Fiona to read for us.
Reading is taken from 1 John chapter 5, verses 1 to 5. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone who loves the Father loves his child as well. This is how we know that we love the children of God, by loving God and carrying out his commands. In fact, this is love for God, to keep his commands, and his commands are not burdensome, for everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. Amen.
Thanks, Fiona, for reading for us. Keep that open if you've got it open in your church Bibles. And just before Davi comes to preach, to help us to explore that passage, we're going to sing once again words from Psalm 37, which say, "Wait on the Lord and keep his way." And when the Bible says wait on God, it's not like waiting for a bus, wondering if he'll show up or not. No, God is here with us. God is with us daily as he lives in our hearts by his Spirit. To wait on God is to lean on him, to trust in him, to depend upon him. So as Emma leads us, let's stand again and sing.
Wait on the Lord and keep his way.
I saw the wicked great
Please do take a seat.
Good morning. Good morning. Good to see you all this morning. Please do keep that passage open in your Bibles. That's page 1228. We'll be making reference to it throughout, as well as verses and things will come up on the slides. Before we start, let me pray for us as we turn to God to listen to him from his word. Let's pray. Our Lord, our God, you promise to teach, to instruct, to direct, to chastise, to correct those who sit under your word. We pray and we expect that that will be true this morning. Encourage and raise our affections afresh to you as we hear of the wonderful grace that you have shown us. Remind us of how great you are and how kind and wonderful you are. Give us energy and attention to listen well to you as you speak. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, here's a question to kick us off this morning. How do you know that you're part of your family, besides your name? How do you know that you're part of your family? Well, here's an answer to that question. It may be that it is when you realize that certain unique behaviors and mannerisms are natural to you and to your family that are not natural to any other family. Those of us perhaps who are married will feel this a little bit more keenly. There may be some here who have felt natural changes come upon themselves because of their joining a new family. Behaviors, mannerisms begin to feel normal that didn't feel normal or natural before because they've been engrafted into this new community, this new family. I asked Emma, my wife, this question earlier on this week. I said, when did you feel like you were truly a DePaula? When did you know that you were a DePaula? She said, my parents are here, so I'll be careful, but she said that it was when it felt comfortable, when it felt natural for her to wear flip-flops around the house. That's when she knew that she was part of the family. Before that, that would have been a strange, unnatural thing for her to do. But because she was part of our family, suddenly, this was a natural expression of the legitimate fact that she was now a DePaula. It was natural to her. Well, as we come to this last section in John's letter, we'll see the themes that he has brought up throughout the letter be drawn together as a last attempt to assure the reader that he or she is a genuine, real, saved for eternity Christian. And John is going to do that specifically in these verses by reminding the reader that they really have been born again into a new family. They have been born again into a new family. They really are part of his new family. And John does that by highlighting the things that come naturally to those who have been born again and who are part of that new family. The members of that family, they have three characteristics. They believe specific things about Jesus. They have faith in him. They love God their Father and are capable of obeying him, and they love his other children because of that faith that they have that has overcome the corrupting powers of the world. They believe in Jesus, they love and obey their Father, and they love their brothers and sisters. How do you know you're part of God's family? Those things are natural to you. They're natural to you. That's how you know you're a child of God. Well, we're going to look at each of these characteristics in more detail. But first, let's get a bird's eye view of what John is trying to say by looking at his quick summary that he does in verse 1. That's point 1 on your sheets if you're following along. And here it is, verse 1. Let's read that again. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone who loves the Father loves his child as well. Well, in this verse, John sums up those three telltale signs that mark off those who have been born again, born into new life, members of God's family. What are they? We just mentioned them. They believe Jesus is the Christ. They love the Father, and they love his children. That's what you expect of those who have been born again, born of God. They understand that who Jesus is, objectively. He's the Messiah Christ sent by God to save his people and to rescue them to himself. He has done that through the cross for me and for you, for us. Children of God recognize naturally who Jesus is in relation to them. He is their Savior. Naturally, they love their new father, don't they? Who sent his son to adopt them into his new family. And naturally, they love his children. Now, the NIV renders the end of that verse, everyone who loves a father loves his child as well, which might imply a reference to Jesus, his son. Now, one disagrees with Bible translators at one's peril, but I think the sense in this verse is that this is a general description of anyone who has come from God, any of his children. I don't think there's anyone specific in mind. Luckily for me, other Bible translators agree. So, in the ESV, this verse reads, and everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of him, i.e., his other children. So, to sum up, the children of God, they believe specific things about Jesus in relation to them. He is their Savior, the Christ. They love their Father, and they love those others that come from him, his other children. In other words, our brothers and sisters. This is what's true of those who are in God's family. Now, the question on everyone's lips, reading this, and perhaps on our lips as well this morning, is that really the case for me? Is that the case for me? Well, John is going to reassure his readers that that is the case for them by giving them a little case study, you might call it. He's going to show us what it takes to love God's children. What does it take to love God's children? And as he unpacks that, the implications of that, we'll be convinced that we do possess those telltale signs of being the children of God. Because what it takes to love God's children is an obedience to God born of a love for him that can only come from genuine, life-changing faith that rips you from the grip of the world. In other words, if you're born again, you can't help but exhibit these three characteristics that the children of God have in your life. You'll believe in Jesus as your Christ. You'll love God and obey him, and you'll love others. These three aspects, characteristics of being a child of God are logically, fundamentally linked. They don't exist alone. If you have one, you have the other ones. It's like trying to braid some hair with three strands. One needs the other. One is supported by the other. Only together do they make a braid. It's like a package deal, you know. You buy any of them, you get the other two free. They come together as one. Belief in Jesus, faith in him, love for God, and love for others. They come together. And that's important for us to grasp because often the source of our lack of assurance from time to time, and the lack of assurance that maybe these readers in John's time were feeling back then, was perhaps this tendency to separate these characteristics out as if they're independent or detachable from one another. So we might say something like, yeah, I believe Jesus is the Christ and he's my Savior, but I'm not sure I love God enough. Therefore, we conclude, I must not be one of his children. The math doesn't add up there for John. Or similarly, we might say, I believe in Jesus. He really was the Christ. He died for me, but I don't love others well enough to be sure that I'm one of his children. Maybe I'm not safe for eternity. And then what happens? Our zeal, our relationship with God suffers. We get down in the dumps. The joy that we once found in the gospel disappears. John wants to convince us of the fact that that is just the math in those thinkings, the calculation in those thinkings doesn't add up. He wants us to stop thinking like that, and he wants to convince us of the natural implications of our status as children of God. And he wants to highlight to us how it is the case that we do display a love for God and a love for others in our lives if we are children of God. So as we unpack these characteristics, John wants us to recognize them in ourselves as we go through them. And he wants us to be encouraged that we have the real deal. We are children of God. Verse 1, the big sum up. That's what John is trying to achieve. That's what he's going to be talking about. Let's have a look at these characteristics. Point 2, children of God lovingly obey the Father, and so they love his children. Let's read verses 2 and 3 again. This is how we know that we love the children of God, by loving God and carrying out his commands. In fact, this is love for God, to keep his commands, and his commands are not burdensome. John's point is simple, isn't it? All he's doing is highlighting the fact that you can't genuinely love the children of God without having love for God himself. And that love for God looks like obedience to him. So if you're one of those who feel like your status as a child of God is discredited by your lack of love for others, well, you listen up. Because maybe you're looking around this room and you're thinking, well, I don't hate these people around me, but I'm not sure if I love them. My relationship with God is going well, but I don't feel love for these people. Is there something wrong with me? Am I safe? Is this right? Well, John says, don't worry about that. Here's a surefire way that you know that you're loving others. You can know that you're loving others if you can say that you love God. Think about that. The best, most loving thing I can do for you, that you can do for others in your church family, is to ensure that you're walking closely with God, loving him and obeying him. Well, how can that be the case? Well, to get that, I think we need to first redefine love in our minds a little bit. To us, instinctively, love means a feeling, doesn't it? It's an emotion. It's something that you feel. It happens to you. And sure, that's true sometimes, but that's only a part of it, isn't it? I think a better way of thinking about love is to think of it as a heart commitment that dictates my choices and my actions in light of others. Sure, it involves emotions, but it also involves moral, practical action. Someone can say they love you, and maybe they can even feel it, but if they treat you terribly, that's not love, is it? That's something else. Love comes with actions. And John made that clear in the previous chapter. To John, God's love primarily looks like not how he feels about us, but the fact that he has sent his son as a sacrifice. That's how you know God loves, because of what he does. That's why John finds it so easy to put love and obedience so close together. He even says, love for God is obedience to him. That's how intimately love and action go hand in hand. And so in practice, this means that if I obey God, I love him. And if I love him, I'll obey his commands. And I won't lie. And I'll try not to cheat. And I won't steal. And I won't have an affair. And I'll restrain my greediness and my temper. And instead, I'll be generous and kind. And guess what? Who benefits from that? Your brothers and sisters. You love them as you obey the Lord. And as we hear that, as we sit and listen to that, we know, as born-again children of God, that God's commands are not burdensome. We're convinced that they are good. We get that logic. To those on the outside, those who are not in the family, they don't get that. That doesn't come naturally to them. But for us, it does. Well, perhaps there's someone here who, maybe you hear the words God's commands and instinctively you recoil at the thought of being restricted and burdened by them. Hopefully you begin to see that they're not like that. Truly, to obey God is to love others. Of course, sinlessness is not expected. That's not possible. But an appreciation, an affection, a desire to obey, that is present in the children of God naturally. Because they naturally see God's commands as a good thing. And they are glad to have their lives reflect them. To want to obey and to love God, to ensure a close walk with Him, is the best, most loving thing I can do for my brothers and sisters in my family. And there, I think there's an encouragement to be had there for us in this church family. We're a church family at peace, aren't we? We're not perfect, let's be honest. But we're kind and generous, not selfish and greedy. We are united. That is a sign of the fact that there truly are children of God in this place. We love God, and naturally, out of obedience to Him, we love others. But you might be thinking, well, I do that sometimes, but not all the time. Sometimes I'm in a good place with God, but other times I worry I don't love Him enough or obey Him enough. Am I safe? How is that for me? Well, John wants to reassure us on that front as well. The fact that there is a desire for obedience at all is telling of a characteristic that only the children of God have. And that is that they do love God because they have victory over the world because of their faith. That's our next point. The faith of the children of God in Jesus gives them capacity to do this. That is, love God and others. Verses 4 and 5, John continues, "For everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. What is it that overcomes the world? Only the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God." So here's the thing we need to grasp. Our love of God, our desire to obey and to please Him and to love others, that is not a naturally occurring thing within human beings. And the world conspires against such a thing, and its grasp is strong. John has described the world so far in this letter as the realm of Satan, of sin, and of lies. These are Satan's efforts at undermining and destroying what God seeks to achieve in His creation. The world has a powerful grip on humanity, and there's nothing we can do to free ourselves from it except what the Lord gives us through faith. Victory over the world. That's what allows us even to want to obey the Lord and His commands. We're set free from the world. We overcome it. Whereas before we were bound as slaves to the world and its selfish and its sinful, its immoral ways, now we aren't. And we don't have to fall in line, whereas before we did fall in line so easily. So here's the big encouragement. If there is concern, if there is worry in your heart at your lack of love for God, at your lack of love for others, well, that's telling. It's telling of a renewed mind which longs to love and obey. And guess what? Only those who have been set free from the world can feel that. Only those who are born again, only those who are children of God naturally feel that way because they're part of His family. The faith which gives us victory over the world, that is founded on specific beliefs about Jesus, that He's the Christ, He's the Son of God. And then so if you can say that Jesus is sent from God and He's my Savior, you have overcome the world. And the telltale signs of being in God's family, love for God, love for others, well, they come naturally. They come naturally. So, here's what John is reminding us of this morning. Here's a family of brothers and sisters who who have been born again, detached, set free from the world through faith, meaning that they know who Jesus is and who he is in relation to them, meaning that naturally they love the Father who sent them and are glad to obey him, which means that naturally they love each other. Do you see how one thing flows from the other? One thing follows the other. Of course, that doesn't happen perfectly. And that might give us cause for worry from time to time. And that's okay. Complacency is a dangerous thing. John warns us about that in this letter too. But here's the point for this morning. Here's the big takeaway. Don't underestimate or undermine the work of God in your life. You believe things about Jesus which the world thinks is ridiculous. You long to love and obey God the Father. You're frustrated when you don't. You long to love your brothers and sisters. That's the experience of the children of God in this life. Remember that. Because there's not much to do in light of what John teaches here. There aren't any do's or don'ts. There aren't any oughts or ought-nots in these verses. There are simply statements of fact. Everyone who is born of God and is part of his family believes in Jesus, loves God and obeys him, and loves others. There's nothing to do except remember that and know that I am a legitimate member of God's family because I have been given victory over the world through faith. That means I love to obey God and I love my brothers and sisters. These things come naturally to God's children. They're evidenced in our church life. We have the real deal. We do. Let's pray. Why don't we take a second just to think back, meditate upon what the Lord has taught us this morning. Our Father, we are so grateful to you this morning for the grace that you have shown us, the victory that you have given us over the world, which means that we are your children who profess with our lips that Jesus is Lord, who love and obey you, and who naturally love those around us. Father, we pray that we would know this to be true of us more and more. And as we begin to grow in our assurance and certainty of this, would those characteristics be more and more on display? We thank you for your kind and encouraging word to us this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, we're going to sing once more of the assurance that we can have because of what God has given us. Let's stand and sing again. Thank you.
Let's remain standing for a final prayer. And now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ, our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. Please do sit. And again, let me say thank you for being with us today. Don't forget to stick around if you can for refreshments. Chrissy and Angela will be happy to serve you at the back there. Don't forget, if you can help provide stuff for the coffee morning, sign up at the back. Don't forget your monthly record magazine. And don't forget, no small groups yet until the 24th of August.